So today we're going to be talking about the second part or the second chapter in the manual, which is entitled Let Us Go On. In Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1, it says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ. In other words, leaving something behind. Let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and faith towards God, etc. And then in verse 3 it says, and this we will do if God will permit us to. So, you know, the Apostle Paul in this passage of Scripture is talking about the Christian life as a journey. It is a journey. Most people, most Christians stop somewhere on the journey and don't go any further. But Paul said that this is a journey. We have to go on. And leaving behind the basic foundations which need to be established in our life, once they are established in our life, then we can start to move on. And so they're constantly moving on. But to move on, these foundations have to be laid. And so the Bible tells us, if God permit, why wouldn't he permit us? Or not permit us to move on. You see, this, if we don't establish these foundations in our life, not just as head knowledge, but as experience and as a constant reality of walking in them in our daily lives, God will not allow us to go further on into the kingdom of God. We need to really understand this so that we don't get bogged down at a level and stay there for the rest of our lives. If God permit, then he says, let us go on to perfection. It's an interesting word in the Greek language, and it has a meaning of completeness or to finish the journey. And he's talking about a process of starting point and a finishing point. And, you know, most Christians live their Christian lives on a very mediocre level. And, you know, they don't go any further. They reach a point and they stay there. And, you know, that's really not what it's all about. We are to continue on. We are to move on. For instance, you know, some people just receive salvation, they may experience the baptism in water, and that's where they stay. And quite often, these levels are set by the teachings of specific denominations. And so you can be born again, you can be baptized in water, and stay there for the rest of your life. But you see, all of these foundations have to be laid in order for us to move on. And it's really important that we understand this. You know, the Apostle Paul had some problems with the Corinthian church, the church of Corinth. And he said in 1 Corinthians 3 and verse 1, he said, and I, brethren, could not speak to you as unto spiritual, but you were just babes in Christ. And verse 2, I have fed you with milk and not with meat. For hitherto you were not able to bear it, and you're still not able to bear it. And so this is the problem he had with the Corinthian church. And these foundations, these six foundations, are known as the teachings of Christ. Therefore, Hebrews 6:1, leaving the principles of the doctrine or the teachings of Christ. And so these teachings of Christ have to be laid in our lives. You know, it's really important that Jesus talked about the foundations we build upon. They have to be right. And, you know, it talks about Jesus as being the stone in Acts chapter 4 and verse 11. This is the stone, it says, which was set at naught of you builders, which became the head of the corner. See, his teachings are the foundations. The teachings of Jesus are the stone. And Matthew chapter 7 in verse 24 says, whoso heareth these sayings of mine, I will liken him to a wise man which built his house upon the rock. See, these sayings of mine. So they are the teachings of Jesus. And only when these foundations are properly laid can we move on. The six foundations are these: repentance from dead works, faith towards God, the doctrine of baptisms, the doctrine or the teaching of laying on of hands, the teaching of the resurrection of the dead, and the teaching on eternal judgments. So we look at the first one today, this foundation, repentance from dead works. It's a foundation stone that has to be laid in our lives. And so the voyage into the kingdom of God starts with repentance. It is a turning point from this world into another world, the kingdom of God. And salvation obviously starts with and is realized by continuous repentance. Not just a one-off thing, but a lifestyle of repentance. You see, Mark chapter 1 and verse 15, it says, "And saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand." See, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. We enter in through repentance and believing the gospel. You know, but we need to understand this is not just a one-off event. This is a continuous experience, and it must become a way of life. The attitude of repentance needs to be built into our lives as an ongoing experience. See, it is the work of the Holy Spirit to bring us to repentance. In John chapter 16 and verse 8 it says, And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and judgment. See, that's the work of the Holy Spirit. And the Apostle John, when writing to the New Testament church around AD 90, talks about the need of continuous repentance. And John made it clear that if we are to walk in continuous fellowship with the Lord, we have to walk in continuous repentance. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 8 reads like this: "If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us." Now, he's talking to Christians here, spiritual Christians. Verse 9: "And if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar." And then in verse 1 John 2 and verse 1: "My little children, these things are right unto you, that you sin not. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Christ Jesus." Now, as we embark upon this walk into the kingdom of God, the further we go, the level of purity in our lives increases. Okay, which means there is a continuous state of repentance going on in our lives. The further we go into the kingdom of God, the greater the conviction of sin by the Holy Spirit in our lives. And we begin to realize that the requirements now as we move on become greater. You know, up to this point, there are many things in our lives which we wouldn't even consider as sin until we get further into the kingdom of God. And the Holy Spirit begins to unveil a whole new level of necessity for purity in our lives. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 18: "But the path of the just is as a shining light that shineth more and more unto that perfect day." You see, that perfect day. Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 7 tells us, "The way of the just is uprightness. Thou most upright do weigh the path of the just." So the Holy Spirit monitors. You see, we cannot go further until further levels of purity have been established within our lives. This is staged throughout our Christian walk. It is part of the journey. And as God convicts us of sin, we repent. And so the further we walk into the kingdom, the more purity is required of us. It's like the way becomes narrower as we move further forward into the kingdom of God. This is not just to limit us. This actually frees us. The pull of this world is slowly being broken in our lives as we enter further into another world, an unseen world of the kingdom of God. You know, what we call sovereign experiences, or experiences which come into our lives which have nothing to do with our purity of heart, have nothing to do with our standing before God. They're sovereign. God just gives us sovereign experiences. And they're usually kind of one-off experience, you know. But to walk in that realm requires purity of heart. Sovereign experiences where God comes on the scene, gives us a dream, a vision, something happens to us in the spiritual realm and God takes us into something. Those are sovereign experiences, the one-off events, and we don't walk in them. They have nothing to do with our purity of heart or our qualifying for them. We just call them, oh, they were just a sovereign experience of God. But to walk in that level, the further we go, the more purity he requires. That's why this process of repentance is an ongoing thing. And so we need to understand this. To walk in the light and have fellowship with the Lord requires that we embrace a lifestyle of repentance. You know, it's very, very interesting. In the Old Testament, we have a picture of heaven. We have a picture of the kingdom of God in the tabernacle that Moses built. And, of course, the tabernacle had an outer court. And then it had what they call the holy place, where there was a candlestick and the table of showbread and so on. And then there was the holiest of all. But it's interesting. God was manifest in the last compartment called the holiest of all. That's where the manifest presence of God was. The closer you get in the tabernacle to the manifest presence of God, the more gold that God requires. Now, you know, this is interesting. If you look in the furniture of the outer court, it was made of wood and it was made of brass. In the inner court, the candlestick and the altar of incense was made of gold. In the holiest of all, the Ark of the Covenant was covered in gold. See, the high priest would not dare go into the holiest of all with something made of brass.